thing, I mean, on just introducing the adults. So everyone can hear me, right?
Yes.
Oh, thanks. Okay, so first of all, remember that in yesterday's and day before yesterday's talk, I assumed that the character chi was trivial, okay? And we constructed, given any modulo form f, we constructed a function phi f from SL2 of R modulo gamma to C. Okay, so if chi is non-trivial, the same construction will not work. Okay, you can check that instead of, so I'm calling that function capital FF instead of phi f, because now phi f will be adelic. So if you follow the same construction, what you will get is a function which satisfies its value on gamma g will be chi of gamma times its value on g, okay? So it will not be left gamma invariant, it will be only chi comma gamma equivariant, okay? So that is one reason why we are going to actually move to adels, and we are going to move from SL2 to GL2, okay? So GL2 can capture the subtleties associated to that chi, and that chi is going to manifest in what is called central characters of representations. But anyway, so this is our aim, okay? We want to construct, given f, the function phi f as a function on a certain group called GL2 of A modulo G, on a certain quotient called GL2 of A modulo GL2 of Q, okay? I'm going to explain what these terms are. I'll explain what A is. So instead of studying the right regular representation of SL2 of R on SL2 of R modulo gamma, as gamma varies over various gamma naught of n, instead we will study the right regular action of GL2 of A modulo on this space that we are going to write called L2 of GL2 of A modulo GL2 of Q. Okay. So things are going, there will be some change of notation at some point. G will stand for GL2, G of A will stand for GL2 of A, and G of Q will denote GL2 of Q. Okay. Okay, so let us now go ahead. Our chi was a Dirichlet character Z mod NZ star to C star. And recall that these are anyway important objects. They come up in things like Dirichlet's theorem on primes in arithmetic progressions. Okay, so one motivation to construct adels could be that instead of allowing n to vary and considering various characters of Z mod NZ star, we want to view all of them as characters of a single group A star mod Q star, which is independent of n. Okay, so we want to construct such an A star. Okay, so note that Z star will not suffice for this purpose anyway, because you have a surjective ring homomorphism from Z to Z mod NZ. But if you have a surjective ring homomorphism and you pass to units, Z star to Z mod NZ star, that is not surjective. Z star is just plus or minus one, whereas Z mod NZ star has phi of n elements, right? So we are going to first, our first step is actually to enlarge Z to a ring Z hat. It'll have the following property. That also has a surjection from Z hat to Z mod NZ. But this time there'll be an additional property. Z hat star to Z mod NZ star at the level of units, that map is also going to be surjective, okay? So if you have a character from Z mod NZ star, you will be able to pull back and have a character on Z mod Z hat star, okay? So that's going to be the first step. So two facts are going to help us for constructing this Z hat. First is the familiar Chinese remainder theorem, okay? So Chinese remainder theorem gives you this expression, Z mod NZ is product of Z mod Pi to the Ai Z, depending on the prime factorization of N, okay? So there are two versions of Chinese remainder theorem that one sees. One is a group or module version. The other is a ring version, okay? So we'll use the ring version, namely the ring Z mod NZ star is isomorphic to the product ring. Okay, in the module version, you talk of direct sum. In the ring version, you talk of products, okay? So the ring version has the advantage that you can go to the group of units and you get Z mod NZ star is isomorphic to product I equals 1 to n, Z mod Pi to the Ai Z star, okay? And there is a compatibility between these isomorphisms as n varies. Let's not worry about it for now. Okay, so I have just repeated what I wrote at the end of the last slide here. Okay, so now let me very briefly recall what the periodic numbers are, the definition. So the usual Archimedean absolute value on R, which contains Q, we are not going to write it with the usual absolute value symbol, but with an additional subscript of infinity. We have a different absolute value called the periodic absolute value on Q, which is defined as follows. Sorry, there is a typo. I should have written Q to R greater than or equal to zero, right? Because the absolute value of zero is going to be zero. Okay, so that's a typo. Okay, so what are you going to do? Given a rational number X, its periodic absolute value is going to be P raised to negative of the largest power of P divides X, which divides X. Okay. So for instance, the absolute value of P is going to be P inverse. Absolute value of P raised to minus 2 is going to be P square. Okay. And absolute value of anything which is relatively prime to P is going to be 1. Okay. So we can define a metric using the absolute value. The distance between two elements A and B of Q is going to be the periodic absolute value of A minus B. You can check that it is a metric. So you have it on Q and you have it on Z. You complete it, you get QP, which is a metric space, right? You complete a metric space, you get a metric space. And you can check that the field structure on Q gives you a field structure on QP upon completion. Just like when you use the usual absolute value, the Q, field structure on Q gave you a field structure on R, okay? So QP is actually a topological field. And inside that, when you complete just Z, you have ZP. That's a topological ring, okay? So this is one way. So just to give you a feel for this metric, periodic metric, the distance between A and A plus P raised to 100 will be P raised to minus 100. So it will be very small because P raised to 100 is divisible by a large power of P. The distance between A and A plus P raised to minus 3 plus P raised to minus 4 will be as large as P raised to 4. And the distance between A and A plus 1 will be 1. Okay. So if you are comfortable with ring theory, there are other ways to think of ZP. You can think of it as the completion of the localization of Z at the prime ideal P, or you can think of it as an inverse limit. So these perspectives will make something simpler anyway. Okay, so some of the facts is that ZP is a ring containing Z. QP is its quotient field, and it has the property that if M and P are relatively prime, where M is an integer, you think of M as an element of ZP, okay? So if you think of it as an element of ZP, it is actually invertible. So M inverse will also belong to ZP, okay? So in some sense, every prime which is different from P is invertible in ZP. That makes ZP much simpler than Z. At one point of time, somehow you have to worry only about one prime ideal. The second fact about ZP that we are going to need is that for every prime PI and every AI, you have a surjection from ZP to ZP modulo PI to the, sorry, that's a typo. It should have been PI to the AI ZP, okay? So that surjection, moreover, that ZP mod PI to the AI ZP is isomorphic to Z mod PI to the AI Z. Why? Because Z sits inside ZP. Therefore, Z mod PI to the AI Z maps to ZP mod PI to the AI ZP, and that map is an isomorphism. Okay. And this has an advantage that, so you look at the map from Z to ZP to Z mod PI to the AI Z. Again, that should be P. Sorry, this. So you see, all the P's that you see here should be PI's, okay? So I made a lot of typos. So you have ZPI to Z mod PI to the AIZ. You take the map at the level of units, ZPI star to Z mod PI to the AIZ star. That map is actually a surjection, okay? So remember that Z star to Z mod NZ star is not a surjection. Whereas if you pass to ZPI, that problem goes away, okay? So this is one of the facts which is actually going to help us. Okay, so let us summarize where we are. So first of all, we had this Chinese remainder theorem, which said that product Z mod PI to the AIZ is isomorphic to Z mod NZ. And at the level of group of units in magenta color, you had a similar equation. And then what did we notice? We noticed that product I equal to 1 to N ZPI surjected onto product I equals 1 to N Z mod PI to the AIZ. Okay, So you have a surjection from there to Z mod and Z. And at the level of ring of units, group of units also, we saw that we had a similar vertical surjection. Okay. Now, you can map from the product of all ZP to the product of some of the ZP by ignoring the components other than the PIs. Okay. So you have this product of rings, the leftward horizontal maps in the bottom rows. And at the level of group of units also, you have a surjection. Okay. So now what have we done so far? If you go from bottom to right in the clockwise direction, product over PZP is a ring. It surjects to Z mod NZ. And if you look at the group of units, you have the group of units product over PZP star. Again, go clockwise. It surjects all the maps or surjections. It surjects to Z mod NZ star. Okay. So that helps us in our first step to lift characters of Z mod NZ star upstairs. Okay. So summary, you have this ring Z hat, which you are defining to be product of overall prime of ZP. Then we saw that you have this surjective ring homomorphism clockwise with blue on the left. And then when you pass to the group of units, you have Z hat star mapping surjectively to Z mod NZ star. Okay. And in fact, you can verify that this is just obtained by the map from Z hat to Z mod NZ is actually obtained by modding by the ideal generated by N. Okay. Therefore, our first step, we have some progress in our first step. Characters of each Z mod NZ star as varies, N varies, can be viewed as characters of a single group, namely Z hat star. Okay. So now let us define what is called the ring of finite ideals. Okay. So far, we figured out how to put generalized Dirichlet characters under one umbrella, but to deal with modular forms or even to deal with Dirichlet characters, some more properties of Dirichlet characters, we'll have to enlarge Z hat further to a bigger ring. Okay. So the first step in that enlargement is the ring of finite ideals. So recall QP containing ZP. Okay. So this definition, this style of definition is going to be very important for today. One way to define the ring of AF of finite ideals is as follows. For every prime P, you have QP. And you can take the product of all QP, okay? But if you do that, you lose all information about what might be an integer and what might not be an integer or something of that sort. So instead of considering the product of all the QP, you look at its subset, which satisfies the property that consists of tuples AP, where P ranges over primes, such that for all but finitely many P, the element AP actually belongs to ZP. Okay. So henceforth, all but finitely many will be abbreviated to almost all. Okay. So this is called the ring of finite ideals. So in other words, it is not quite the direct product of the QP, but it's a subset called the restricted direct product, where you are restricting the direct product by requiring that for almost all P, the Pth component should be actually an integer. Okay. So this is not just a subset. You can easily check that this is stable under addition and multiplication. So this is actually a subring. Okay. So notice that for any finite subset S of primes, AF has a subset AF comma S. What is it? You look at those AP as P varies such that whenever P does not belong to S, AP belongs to ZP. Because S was a finite subset, AFS is a subset of AF, and in fact, it is a subring of AF. Okay, and it has a more pleasant structure than AF, namely, at P element of S, you are just looking at QP. Outside P element of S, you are looking at ZP. Okay, so it's a very, very nice, polite ring sitting inside AF. Okay, moreover, the definition of AF tells you that every element of AS belongs to some such AF comma S, right? Because for every AP P in AF, outside some finite set S, AP has to belong to ZP, okay? So does anyone have any questions so far?
Not it.
Thanks. So I have just repeated from the previous page. This is the definition of AFS. It's a product and AF is the union of these. Okay, so now I want to give a topology on AF. Okay, but on AF, I do not want to give the product topology from QP. AF is contained in the product of QP. I'm not going to give the product topology, but each AF comma S is actually a product. Okay, so each AF comma S, I'm going to give it the product topology. And there is a way to paste together the various topologies on the AFS to give you a single topology on the union AF. Okay, so the statement is that AF has a unique topology which satisfies the following conditions. First of all, each AF is an open subset of AF. And on each AFS, the topology given is the blue topology above, namely product topology from this product. Okay, so this construction of AF from the QP and the ZP is what is called the restricted direct product construction. We are constructing the ring of finite ideals not just as a set or a group, but as a topological space. Okay, because the restricted direct product construction gives you a natural union, and each element of that union is a product which can be given the product topology. So once you give this topology to AF, you can check that the ring structure on AF, the addition and multiplication and subtraction and so on are continuous for the topologies that you have provided. So AF is actually a topological thing. Okay. So here is an example of such a subset. AF contains the subset AF comma empty set. Okay. But what is empty set? Outside the empty set, every component has to belong to ZP. So this is just the product of ZP, which is Z hat. Okay. So this is an open subset because each AF comma S was open in AF. Okay. So Z hat sits inside AF as an open subset. Okay. Moreover, you have an injective ring homomorphism from Q into AF. How do you do this? Given an element X in Q, I want to tell you what is its image in AF. Every element is a tuple as primes vary. So I want to tell you what the pth entry is. So as the pth entry, I just look at the image of X under the injection from Q to QP, right? QP is a completion of Q. So Q sits inside QP. So at the pth place, I just look at the image of X. Okay. So at every place, I'm looking at the image of the same X. That's why I'm using the word diagonal. Okay. So for the rest of this talk, you are going to hear the word diagonal many times. Okay, so this is an injective ring homomorphism. And for the rest of the talk, often when you have a ring homomorphism, which is injective, you might think of the source of the homomorphism as a subring of the target of the homomorphism. Okay, I did not explain to you why the image, why the right-hand side actually belongs to AF. The reason is that if you have a rational number X and P does not divide the denominator of X, then we already noticed that the image of X in QP is actually belongs to ZP. Okay. So this we had noticed before. Therefore, this actually lands inside AF comma S, where S is the set of primes dividing the denominator of X. Okay. So we have a ring homomorphism from Q into AF. Okay. So finally, now we can define ideals. Okay. So to define ideals, we introduce terminology of what a place means. By a place V, we mean either a prime P or we refer to infinity as a place. Okay, set of all primes union infinity. Okay, if you have a prime P, we'll also call it a finite place. Infinity we'll call an infinite place. Okay, when we write Q infinity, we mean R. So for every V place, we have something called QV. If V is a prime, we have QP. If V is infinity, Q infinity is the same as R. Okay. So with all this, we can now define ideals. The ring of ideals, one way to define it as, I already defined you for you the ring of finite ideals, AF. You just multiply with R, which is Q infinity. Okay. And give it the product topology. Okay. So you can verify that it's a topological ring. Or more concretely, In terms of primes or places, you can define AF in the following way. To give an element of AF is to give XV for every finite place V. To give an element of R is to give XV for the infinite place V equals infinity. So to give an element of A, it is the same as giving XV for every V. Okay. So for every place V, you are giving an element of QV. And because you have the same condition that you had for AF, namely for all but finitely many primes P, XP had to belong to ZP. Okay. So this is the way of defining adels. So if you recall what restricted direct product means, this is the same as saying that A is not quite the direct product of all the QV, but A is a subset of the product of QV with the additional requirement that for almost all V outside infinity, namely for almost all P, the component XP has to actually belong to the ring ZP. Okay. So we say that A is the restricted direct product of the QV with respect to the ZP, which lies inside QP for almost all P. Okay. So almost all V is the same as almost all P, as long as you exclude infinity, which is only one place. Okay. Again, I gave A the topology called the product topology. But then when I defined A as a restricted direct product, there is also the restricted direct product topology on A. Okay. I defined how to define a topology for a restricted direct product. These two topologies happen to agree. Okay. We'll review that notion when we need it later. Okay. So it's a fact that with this topology, A is a topological ring. And again, you have a diagonal quote unquote injective ring homomorphism from Q to A, where X goes to the tuple XV with, for each place V, XV is the image of X under the embedding Q into QV. Okay. So for every V, Q sits inside QV, whether it be QP or R, and you take X to its image, which we call XV. So you get an injective ring homomorphism from Q into A. Okay. So here is a fact. Thinking of Q, so I said that you can embed Q diagonally into A. So you think of that embedding as an injection of rings. This makes Q into a discrete subgroup of the additive topological group A. Okay. So those are just some words. So I said that A is not just a ring, it's a topological ring. Whenever you have a ring, you can think of it as a group under addition. Similarly, whenever you have a topological ring, you can think of it as a topological group under addition. Okay. So Q is now being viewed as a subgroup of A. And this subgroup is actually discrete. What does discrete mean? Discrete means that every point in Q has a neighborhood which meets no other point of Q. Okay. Now, if you are familiar with adels, let me recall the rough idea of the proof. If you are not familiar with adels, don't bother about it. So consider the element 0 inside Q. I want a neighborhood of it in A. I want a neighborhood of 0 in A, which does not meet any element of Q other than A. Okay. So here is the neighborhood that I'm going to choose. Product over PZP at each of the finite places. And at the infinite place, I choose minus 1, 1. Okay. All this is happening in product over PQP. So remember that if you remember the definition of the restricted direct product topology, this is actually open inside A, because product over PZP is open in R and minus 1, 1 is open in R. Sorry, product over PZP is open in AF and minus 1, 1 is open in R. And if you look at the intersection of this with Q, the presence of the product over ZP tells you that any intersection has to be actually an integer. And the fact that you have minus 1, 1 tells you that such an integer should also lie in minus 1, 1, and the only such integer is 0. Okay. If you are not familiar with adels, don't bother about this idea. I just wanted to give you some idea of this proof. Okay. Now I have introduced what adels are. Now I want to introduce what ideals are. Okay. So adels are a ring. So you can choose to look at the group of units. The group of units of the ring A or A star is what is called ideals. Okay. So if you recall the definition of the adels, The ideals can be described as follows. Every ideal is first of all an adale, and therefore it has to have the form XVV. Okay, and because it has to be invertible, every XV has to belong to QV star. But for almost all P, its inverse, since it should also belong to an adale, its inverse should also belong to ZP. So XP should actually belong to ZP star for almost all P. Okay, so let me recall. So an element, an ideal means a tuple XVV, V running over all places, such that for all V, XV should belong to QV star. But for almost all P, XP should belong to ZP star. Okay, so in other words, A star is the restricted direct product of the QV star with respect to the subgroup ZP star. Okay, so we give it the restricted direct product topology. Okay, so A star is contained in A, but we do not give it the induced topology from A. We give it a different topology, namely A star is a restricted direct product, and we give it the restricted direct product topology. Okay, so that is the topology on the ideals. Okay, so we'll shortly see another way to think about the topology on ideals when we look at the topology on GL2 of A. Okay, so remember, recall what our idea was. Our idea was how to pass from Hecke characters to characters of ideals. Okay, so characters of A star. So we already know how to think of Dirichlet characters as characters of product ZP star. Now we want to relate that to ideals. Okay, so we have the following ring injective group homomorphisms. First of all, we saw that Q is a subring of A. Okay, so A is actually not just a topological ring, A is a topological Q algebra. Now when Q is a subring of A, the units of Q, which is Q star, maps to the units of A. So you have an injection Q star to A star. And since Q sat inside A diagonally, Q star also sits inside A star diagonally. Okay, so that's the first injection. Second injective group homomorphism, we have product over P ZP star. How do you inject into A star? To describe an element of A star, I need to describe what it is at every place. When you have product over P ZP star, I am describing it only at finite places, right? So there is a remaining infinite place, infinity. There I declare it to be one. Okay, so product over P ZP star sits inside A star this way. Okay, at the infinite place it is one. And finally, the group R star also sits inside A star. Okay, why is that? Because R star sees only the infinite place. It has nothing to do with the finite places. So at finite places, you just declare it to be one. Okay, so you have three different groups sitting inside A star. One is Q star, which sits inside diagonally, and it mediates between the other two subgroups. The first being the product of ZP star over the finite primes, and the other is the group R star corresponding to the infinite primes. Okay, therefore you get a group homomorphism Q star cross product ZP star cross R star maps into A star. Okay, and because A star, you know, it's a commutative group, this is a well-defined group homomorphism. Okay, so you have a well-defined group homomorphism, but this group homomorphism is not an isomorphism. Okay, because minus one in Q star, for instance, sits inside both product ZP star cross R star. Okay, but you can check the following. If you restrict the group homomorphism to a subgroup, the following subgroup, you choose Q star diagonally embedded product over P ZP star, and instead of R star, you only look at the positive reals, then you can check that this group homomorphism is actually an isomorphism. Okay, so as a group, A star has a very, very simple structure. It's a product of these three groups. What is the advantage of this? Whenever you have a character of product over P ZP star, you can view this as a character of A star, right? Because you just declare it to be trivial on the other two factors. You declare it to be trivial on Q star and R star greater than zero. Therefore, you get a bijection from finite order characters of product over P ZP star to finite order characters of A star, which are trivial on Q star and R star. Okay, why did I quite remove the R star greater than zero? Because, sorry, not R star, but R star greater than zero. Okay, so that was the component here. So why did I not say finite order characters of A star which are trivial on both Q star and R star? It is an easy exercise to see. If you have a finite order character of R star greater than zero, it is automatically trivial. Why? Because you can keep taking square roots, right? That will force more and more elements to lie in the image. So the image cannot be therefore the image cannot be finite. Okay, did I goof up there?
No, it's fine.
Yeah, see us as an exercise that finite order characters are automatically trivial on R star greater than zero. So you have this bijection, which is a very simple bijection. And because if you look at the way we define this bijection, the inverse of the bijection is simply restricting along the inclusion product ZP star to A star. Okay. So let me summarize. For every natural number n and every character of Z mod nZ star, we saw how to view chi as a character of product over P ZP star. And this was what we did. Product over P ZP star surjected onto Z mod nZ star, and you can compose any character. Okay. So that was the first step. And second step was to relate from product ZP star to adels. Namely, product ZP star has a projection map from product ZP star cross R greater than, sorry, this should have been R star greater than zero. That is another typo. Sorry for the too many typos. And that we saw was isomorphic to A star modulo Q star, you know, because if you have another Q star, you get A star, and that had a surjection from A star. Okay. So if you go clockwise starting from A star, you get a character of A star starting from the original character on Z mod nZ star. Okay. So you can check the following, that, you know, on A star, you have a topology and Q star sits inside this, and you can check that Q star inside A star is discrete subgroup. And you can check that all finite order characters are continuous. So the previous bijection, we can say something slightly finer, namely every pair n comma chi, where chi is a z character of Z mod nZ star, we associated to it a finite order continuous character of A star mod Q star. Okay. We can actually make this into a bijection if you allow to vary n, provided you identify some of these pairs n comma chi, namely you identify n1 chi1 and n2 chi2 if, you remember how Dirichlet characters are identified, right? If n1 divides n2 and you have this sort of a relation between chi1 and chi2, namely chi2 should be obtained by pulling back chi1 under the map from Z mod n, to Z star to Z mod n1 Z star, okay? In other words, if you restrict it to primitive Dirichlet characters, you get a bijection with finite order continuous characters. Okay. Okay. So let me not explain this point. It's just a technical point. So any questions so far? I'll go ahead. Please.
On page 13.
13. Yeah.
So how is different R star bigger than zero is different from R bigger than zero?
What sorry, sorry, that's a typo.
I want to say that, is there a difference between R star bigger than zero and R bigger than zero? So which point is missing?
So what I mean is that, you know, R star bigger than zero is the same as R bigger than zero, but you know, R star has the group structure, right? So for me, R bigger than zero is a set or a maybe a interval or something, you know, whereas this is a group. Okay. Thanks. But it's good to know that that was kind of okay. Okay. So remember, we wanted to go from modular forms to functions on GL2 of A modulo GL2 of Q. Okay. So first of all, we want to topologize GL2 of A. Okay. If we want to topologize GL2 of A, it is no more difficult than actually topologizing GLN of A. Okay, it's no harder. So for now, I'll actually deal with GLN for the while. Okay, for any ring R, GLn of R is the n by n invertible matrices with entries in that ring. Okay, so GL1 of that ring is just the group of units of that ring. So one way to think of ideals is to think of it as GL1 of A. Okay, this is the reason why the theory of Dirichlet characters is actually the theory of automorphic representations for the group GL1, because GL1 of A is A star. Anyway, okay, so here is how you topologize GLn of A. You look at all the entries of G. G has n squared entries, right? Every n by n matrix has n squared entries. And you also look at the entries of G inverse. So totally you get two n squared entries. So that allows you to map GLn of A into A to the 2n squared. Okay, A to the 2n squared means product of 2n squared copies of A. Okay, so give A to the 2n squared the product topology. We have already given a topology on A, and give GLn of A the subspace topology. Okay, so this is the topology that you give on GLn of A. The same method actually allows you to topologize other groups, like, you know, GLn with values in pretty much any topological ring you want. GLn of AF, GLn of QP, GLn of ZP, GLn of R, GLn of AFS, and so on. Okay, and those who are comfortable with these sorts of things, this actually fits into a very general framework. You can use this to topologize adelic points over any affine variety, but let me not go into it. Okay, now some of you might be wondering that this is not how you have seen GLn of R being topologized, right? How do we usually topologize GLn of R? We embed GLn of R into R raised to n squared, not R raised to 2n squared. Here I am saying that you are embedding into R raised to 2n squared. Okay, so why R raised to 2n squared? The point is that for simple rings like QP, ZP, and R, topologizing GLn over those rings, it is actually enough to take the entries of G itself. Whether you take just G or both G and G inverse, you will get the same topology. But adels and finite adels are more complicated rings, and therefore somehow both G and G inverse need to be taken. Okay. So as a special case, when you want to topologize just GL1 of A, which is A star, it is enough to take both X and X inverse. Okay. In other words, A star does not get the induced topology from the adels, but only the topology by embedding it into A2. Okay. But these are technical points. When you work on the subject, you can, most of the time, you can kind of forget and pretend that nothing is happening. Take these things for granted. Okay, so with the above topologies, I have given a topology on GLn of A. So with the above topologies, GLn of A becomes a topological group. I'm stating without proof, but it is very easy. It's just that matrix multiplication is continuous because, you know, addition is continuous on A, such things. And once you have Q sitting inside A, GLn of Q sits inside GLn of A, right? A matrix with entries in Q is also a matrix with entries in A. And you can check that GLn of Q is a discrete subgroup. Sorry, Saurabh, you have a question or? Oh no, okay, I misinterpreted. Okay, so you have now various topological groups now, A, AF, GLn of A, GLn of AF, GLn of R, GLn of QP, etc. All of these are locally compact. Okay, therefore they have some Haar measure. You can in fact check that all of these are unimodular. Again, take this as a black box, proofs do not matter. Okay, because GLn of Q is a discrete subgroup of GLn of A, the quotient gets a measure, right? If you have a discrete subgroup, complicated at the first sight, but this is actually very simple. What is A? A is a tuple. Every element of A is a tuple, right? So an element of GLn of A is a matrix of tuples. If you have a matrix of tuples, it is also a tuple of matrices. Okay. So instead of thinking of an element of A as a matrix of tuples as over varying places, you can also think of it as a tuple of matrices, each matrix lying in GLn of QV for some V, and you can check that GP has to belong to GLN of ZP for almost all P. So basically, whatever we saw with A, similar things are true for GLN of AS. Okay. So let me not go into the details here. We will not certainly not need it today. And if we need it later, I'll recall. So GLN of A can be similarly pasted from GLN of AS. And each GLN of AS is a product like this. Okay. So now, so you see the focus of this course is really number theory. So we want to get to modular forms. Okay, so remember we had F in MK of gamma naught of n comma chi, and to that we wanted to associate a function from GL2 of A to C, which was invariant under GL2 of Q. Okay, so I have recalled the definition of gamma naught n and stated what chi was. Okay, so here I want to go really slowly. Okay, so it's important to remember the analogy of how we constructed an ideal class character from a character of A star starting from a Dirichlet character. Okay. At that time, we used the fact that Q star cross product ZP star cross R star greater than zero to A star, the multiplication map was an isomorphism of groups. Okay. So we'll kind of have a GL2 variant of this statement, firstly. Secondly, we'll remember what we did for SL2 of our modulo gamma, and we'll somehow combine these two. And starting with the modulo form F, we'll construct a function from GL2 of A over GL2 of Q to C. Okay. So this is what we are going to do. And our temporary aim is as follows. So last time we constructed a function on SL2 of our modulo gamma, provided chi was trivial. Okay, the same construction will give you a function on GL2 of R, but only those elements with determinant greater than zero modulo gamma. Okay, so the same construction can be generalized to what I have written on the left hand side of the bottom equation. Okay, so the first step is to realize GL2 of R determinant greater than zero mod gamma as a further quotient of GL2 of A modulo GL2 of Q. Okay. So that will be the first step. That is, we want to find a subgroup K naught of N of GL2 of A, in fact, which will lie in finite ideals, so that if you further quotient, these two will be the same. Okay. So at this point, let me make an informal remark. How do you think of a seemingly horrible object like GL2 of R modulo gamma? So GL2 of R modulo gamma, I mean, so that is easy because, you know, gamma is discrete. So locally GL2 of R mod gamma looks like GL2 of R.
Okay. So there is a but question. So there is a question in the chat here.
Yeah,
what,
please.
What is gamma here?
Gamma is gamma naught of N. Okay. Sorry. Thank you for the question. Yeah. I did not define it. Gamma is just gamma naught of N. Okay. So now I am having the problem that I'm again not able to kind of, I figured out how to look at the chat. Now I'll have to kind of unshare and reshare, I think, to let go of this. Sorry. So yeah, I think I'll really depend on you. Oh, sorry. I have to close it and then share, I guess. I apologize for this. Okay, good. Okay, so yeah, let me go back. Okay, so I'm making some very informal comments. GL2 of R mod gamma is some kind of extension of upper half plane mod gamma. So you have some mental picture of how that sort of a thing looks like. Okay, but what is this horrible thing called GL2 of A modulo GL2 of Q? Okay, so the point is that you have this group K naught of N such that if you further quotient, you get GL2 of R modulo gamma, and this K naught of N is kind of profinite. Okay, so GL2 of A mod GL2 of Q is something which maps onto every single GL2 of R modulo gamma. Okay, so you allow gamma to vary and go up and up and up. You know, as gamma becomes small, GL2 of R mod gamma goes up and up. You know, it goes becomes bigger and bigger, and GL2 of A mod GL2 of Q is kind of the limit of that, roughly speaking. Okay, so that's some psychologically how to think of this. Okay, so now let us start constructing phi f slowly. So I said that there were three kinds of groups which mapped into A star. You had Q star, positive reals, and product ZP star. Okay, so analogously, we have the following embeddings at the GL2 level. The first embedding is going to be the embedding of GL2 of Q inside GL2 of A. Okay, this we have already discussed. A maps inside A, Q sits inside A, so GL2 of Q sits inside GL2 of A. Okay, and this is diagonal in the sense that X will map to XV, where at each V, XV is the image of X in GL2 of QV. Second, just like positive reals sat inside A star, we are going to sit, make those elements of GL2 of R with positive determinant, which we are going to write GL2 of R plus inside GL2 of A. Okay, so this is the connected component of the topological group GL2 of R. We are going to make it sit inside GL2 of A. And how do we do this? Exactly as R star greater than zero sat inside GL2 of A, namely at every finite place we put one. Okay. Third, this is the more tricky part. Okay, so we'll go slow. How did we put product ZP star inside A star? We just put one at the infinite place, right? But this time, the analog of product ZP star is not going to be simply the product of GL2 of ZP, but it's going to be the group K0 of N. Why is it going to be the group K0 of N? Because we want to ultimately capture modular forms with respect to gamma naught of N. Okay. So on one hand, it is going to be an analog of product over P ZP star. But on the other hand, it is going to be a generalization also of gamma naught of N. Okay. So its definition, so it's going to sit inside product over P GL2 of ZP, but its definition is going to be like the definition of gamma naught of N. Okay. So you don't look at product over P GL2 of ZP. Only thing is that at every place, you require that the element C should be divisible by the by N, right? N is an element of Z, and you can also think of it as an element of ZP. Sorry, question.
What is KP?
Ah, so KP is GL2 of ZP.
Okay.
Yeah, so I remarked at some point that KP, which is GL2 of ZP, is the maximal compact. But we won't have to use it for now. But yeah, so this is what KP is. For every P, we are only looking at those matrices where C is congruent to zero mod N. Okay. So on one hand, this generalizes product ZP star because A and D will kind of be have a lot of flexibility. On the other hand, it also generalizes gamma naught of N. Okay, so this is what K naught of N is. In fact, if you analyze this definition, whenever P does not divide N, N is actually a unit, so everything is divisible by N. Okay, so for those places where P does not divide N, you get the whole of GL2 of ZP. And when P divides N, I have just copied the condition from the first slide of K0 of N. Okay. So this is the analog of product ZP star. And K0 of N is a subgroup of GL2 of AF because it sees only the finite places. And GL2 of AF sits inside GL2 of A by putting the identity element 1 at every infinite place. Okay. So this is the definition of K0 of N. And I want to remark that K0 of N is actually open in GL2 of AF. Why is it open? Because for every P that does not divide N, the factor of K0 of N is the whole of GL2 of ZP. Okay. So if you remember that product GL2 of ZP was open in GL2 of AF, this will actually, and these groups are of finite index, this will actually tell you that K0 of N is actually open in GL2 of AF. Okay. So any questions so far, or anyone wants further clarification on this matter?
There is a question.
Yeah.
What is the meaning of?
I will not look at the chat because I'm afraid of. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm reading it out. So
thank you.
Yeah. That, what is meaning of congruence to 0 modulo n. C is
what is the meaning of what is the meaning of C congruent to 0 modulo n? So n is an element of Z, right?
Yes.
Whereas C is an element of ZP. But if n is an element of Z, it is also an element of ZP. Okay, so C congruent to 0 modulo n means that in the ring ZP, n should divide C. Okay,
Yes, sir.
Other question? Yeah, sorry.
The first thing, when P does not divide n, why that is KP?
So when P does not divide n, then n is a unit in ZP. Okay. Right, when so I had stated at the beginning, ZP has this property that whenever you have any prime number different from P, its reciprocal also belongs to ZP. That is, yes. You know, it's a unit in ZP, and yes. N is only divisible by primes other than P. So the condition that C is divisible by N is automatically satisfied.
Okay, because N is invertible. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Any other question? Okay, so let me go ahead. Okay, so now onwards, we are going to start writing G for GL2. Okay, in the previous lectures, G was SL2, but now we are only interested in GL2. Okay, so G of Q is GL2 of Q. G of R plus is the connected component of GL2 of R, namely determinant greater than 0. And I discovered, I defined this K0 of N, which is contained in GL2 of AF. Okay, which is a compact open subgroup of GL2 of AF, which sits inside GL2 of A with 1 at the infinite places. Okay, so we'll need to use the following facts. Just like Q star times positive real times product ZP star was the whole of A star, you have an analogous equation. G of Q times G of R plus times K0 of N is equal to G of A. Okay, so I'm not going to prove it. The first, it uses two facts. First fact is what is called strong approximation, but strong approximation is only available for SL2 and other simply connected groups, not GL2. Therefore, you will need something else which basically says that K0 of N is big enough to cover all possible determinants so that you can reduce to SL2. Okay, so that's the first fact you will need. So just take for granted this analog. The second analog is an easy exercise. K0 of N is contained in G of AF. It sees only the finite primes. G of R plus sees only the infinite primes. Okay, so if you take the product and intersect with G of Q, what you get is just the subgroup gamma0 of N of G of Q. Okay? So roughly speaking, the fact that you have K0 of N will ensure that your element of G of Q will first of all be an integer because it lies in product GL2 of ZP. And it will also ensure that the matrix entry C is divisible by N. And G of R plus will actually ensure that your element has determinant 1 and not -1. Okay. But anyway, just take this also for granted. And if you use these facts, you can get the bijection that I promised. Okay. Namely, one tells you that G of Q, G of R plus K0 of N is G of A. That tells you that G of R plus maps into G of A. Okay. So the blue part of the equation is G of R plus mapping into G of A. And the fact that this is a bijection will tell you that when you further quotient G of A by G of Q and K0 of N, this is surjective. So one is actually giving you the surjectivity and two will give you the injectivity. So you have a bijectivity. Okay. So any questions?
Not it.
Okay, I'll go ahead. So you have this bijection and you can check that it's a homeomorphism. Okay. So in the special case where chi is 1, this tells us how to get phi f. Okay. Namely, earlier our prescription for phi f was as follows. Now we earlier wrote g, we are going to write g infinity. An element ABCD was mapped to ci plus d to the minus k times f of g infinity times I. Okay. So this was how we defined phi f earlier. Phi f took ABCD to ci plus d to the minus k times f of g infinity times I. Ci plus d was the automorphic factor j, right? If If you slightly modify this prescription, you can extend it to a function from g of L2 of R plus modulo gamma to C star. Okay, namely the only difference that you need to do is that instead of Ci plus D, you have to tag on determinant to the minus half. That's the only difference. If you do that, you will get a function on GL2 of R plus modulo gamma. Okay, but I said that you have a bijection from GL2 of R plus modulo gamma. Sorry, gamma is gamma naught of n. Okay, I should have written that. Sorry for that typo. So gamma naught GL2 of R plus mod gamma is just this quotient. So you can view this as a map from G of A mod K naught of n mod G of Q to C. In other words, you have a map from G of A mod Q to C, which is right K naught of n invariant. Okay. So this is what you do if chi is equal to 1. For general chi, as I said at the very beginning of this talk, this approach does not work, because if you apply the same definition, you only get a map from G of R plus to C, which is not gamma invariant. When you left multiply by gamma, chi of D factor comes out, okay, where gamma is ABCD. So what you need is, you want to somehow take care of that chi of D factor. So let us again revisit what we were doing. We used the following two facts. The first was G of Q, G of R plus times K naught of N is G of A. Second fact was that G of Q intersection K naught of N, G of R plus is gamma naught of N. Okay. So if you have a surjection, if you have one, what one gives you is that, remember K naught of N, the magenta colored K naught of N sits inside the magenta colored G of AF. The blue colored G of R plus sits inside the blue colored G of R. Okay. And what is G of AF times G of R? Because AF cross R is A, G of AF cross G of R is just G of A. Okay. So K naught of N cross G of R, R plus maps to G of A. And if you quotient out by G of Q, the first property is actually telling you that this map is a surjection. Okay. Because G of Q times G of R plus times K naught of N is G of A. Okay. So some of you may be confused that I wrote G of R plus times K naught of N above, whereas here I'm reversing the order, but that doesn't matter because K naught of N only sees the finite places. G of R plus only sees the infinite place. So these two commute. Okay. And using two, you can show that the quotient can be identified with gamma naught of N sitting inside the product. Okay. So where, what is gamma naught of N? How does gamma naught of N sits inside the product? So remember that, how did G of Q sit inside G of AF cross G of R? G of Q sat inside G of AF cross G of R diagonally. Similarly, because you know K naught of N was contained in G of AF and G of R plus was in G of R, and this was just an inclusion, you have to put gamma naught of N diagonally in K naught of N cross G of R plus. Okay. So how do you resolve the problem? So there is a chat, Saurabh, can you read it? Is someone cursing me for going overtime or, okay, 12:30, yeah.
There is no chat.
Oh, is it? Okay, sorry, I mean, oh, maybe because I didn't look at the earlier chat, it's showing up as one. Okay. Okay, so you see, so the problem was that the earlier construction only gave you a function on G of R plus, which had this property of that chi of D comes out when you left multiply by gamma naught of N. Okay, so here the solution is that you have to introduce a character on K naught of N, which will cancel off the chi of D factor. Okay, so that is gamma naught of N does map into G of R plus, and that chi of D factor will be somehow cancelled off if you multiply by a character on K naught of N, which takes care of which restricts as the inverse of the chi of D factor. Okay, so this is the idea. Okay, so I'll probably wave hands a bit because I'm running out of time and the precise details are not too important. So roughly speaking, the idea is as follows. what is k naught of n? K naught of n is exactly like gamma naught of n, except that instead of looking at matrices with entries in Z, you are looking at entries in product over PZP. Okay, so let me repeat that statement. K naught of n is somewhat like gamma naught of n, except that with instead of looking for matrices with entries in Z, you are looking at for matrices with entries in ZP. Okay. Okay. On the other hand, the formalism that we had at the beginning was that product over PZP, if you quotient it out by n, right? N is an integer, so n is an element of Z, so that also sits inside product over PZP. So if you quotient out, you get the same Z mod n Z. So just like you had a map from Z, gamma naught of n to Z mod n Z star, which took A B C D to D, you have a map from K naught of n also to Z mod n Z star, which sends A B C D to the image of D inside Z mod n Z star. Okay. So I'm just discussing this by analogy, and the point is that once you have a map from K naught of n to Z mod n Z star, you can compose with chi, which is a character on Z mod n Z star, and you will get a map from K naught of n to C star, which is a character chi K naught of n. Okay. So the compensatory factor is actually the inverse of chi, because you see chi K naught of n, because chi K naught of n restricts to gamma naught of n, because we define the character on K naught of n using the same prescription as the character on gamma naught of n. So to compensate for it, we have to multiply by its inverse. Okay, so let me just summarize and just write down what the construction is. Okay, so don't bother if not all the details are clear. The following is the construction of the function on G of A. Okay, so I'll slowly state what is the construction. You have an element G of A. I want to say what is the value of EF on it. Okay. So first of all, I write G as GQ times G infinity times GK naught of N, where GQ belongs to G of Q, G infinity belongs to G of R plus GK naught of N belongs to K naught of N. Okay. I need to say what the value of EF on it is, right? So GQ factor, I just ignore. Because after all, we want something which is left invariant under G of Q. With G infinity factor, what I do is, I do exactly what I did before. J of G infinity comma I might to the minus K times F of G infinity times I. Okay, there is absolutely no difference. On the K naught of N factor, I multiply by chi of G K naught of N inverse. This was to compensate for that chi coming out. Okay. So some people, you follow a different approach where instead of looking at D bar and chi inverse, they look at just A. Okay. So that gives you a slightly different automorphic form. So this is one problem with the subject, you know, everyone follows a different notational convention, but so that convention has the advantage that it will behave better with respect to central characters. This has the advantage that this motivates the construction better. Okay. So let me summarize what we did. For every modular form f in mk of gamma naught of n comma chi, we defined a function phi f. One has to check it is well defined, but it is easy. Okay, given g in g of a, go back to the decomposition gq, g infinity, g k naught of n. Completely ignore the gq factor. On the g infinity factor, look at exactly the construction that we did before, except that this time the j factor has a determinant to the half. And on the k naught of n factor, multiply by this chi inverse. Okay. So let me discuss some very easy properties of phi f. So the first property is as follows. Okay, so I'll restate these properties next time. The reason why I'm not stopping now and discussing this is that when you see this for a second time, this will look better, kind of, you know, that this will look easier if you see this two times. Okay. So remember that G of A is G of AF times G of R. Okay, it's a product. So given any function on G of A, you can fix the G of AF component and look at it as a function on G of R factor. Okay. So if you look at phi of f, phi f as a function on g of r factor by fixing the g of a factor, then it's a smooth function on the g of r factor. Okay. How do you see this? This is the same proof as above, because on g infinity, we did exactly the same thing as we did before. Okay. So there is nothing to challenge the smoothness. That g of a f factor is only changing this constant. I mean, well, at least the g k naught of n factor is only changing the constant. So it's easy to see that on the g of a f component, it is actually smooth. Okay, same proof will work. On the other hand, it is a function on g of a f cross g of r. You fix the g of r factor and you look at it as a function on the g of a f factor. Okay, so the claim is that this time the function is again smooth, provided you interpret smooth as locally constant. Okay, why? In the following reason, if you look at the definition of phi f above, it has the following nice transformation property. If you replace g by g times g k naught of n, phi f of g changes by phi f of g times the same character applied to g k naught of n inverse. Okay, so if g k naught of n was lied in the kernel of the character chi, then phi f of g g k naught of n is actually equal to phi f. Okay, so you can check that the kernel is actually open in g of a f. So in fact, if you fix the g of r component, the function phi f is actually invariant under right multiplication by an open compact subgroup. Okay, so that's much stronger than saying locally constant. Okay, and that should not surprise you. You see, g of a mod g of q is a cover, kind of a profinite cover of g of r modulo gamma, and if something comes from g of r modulo gamma, you should expect that under a profinite subgroup that function should be invariant. Okay, so that's the idea. And there is a certain property with respect to central characters. I'll not discuss the proof of this. You can look at the slides, but it is a very simple property. Its statement is very simple. Okay, so suppose you have an element in the center of GL2 of A, namely a center in the GL2 of A is just a scalar matrix. Z is AZ 0 0 AZ. So if you left multiply phi f by an element of Z, what is going to happen to phi f of G? Okay. Now notice that Z of A is isomorphic to A star, right? Any element of Z of A is of the form A 0 0 A inverse with A element of A star. Okay, so I want to say that there is a character omega, so that phi f of zg is going to be equal to omega of z times phi f of g. Okay, so what is the character of A star? So whenever you are asked these sort of questions in mathematics, you should try to guess what is the only thing that you can find. You know, it is like that joke about how to find the thief. You guess who the thief is and then prove that that guy is really the thief. Okay, similarly, what is the only character on A star that you can think of? We started with a Dirichlet character. You can think of that as a character on A star. But that almost works. Only thing is that you have to actually take the inverse of that character. Okay, so this has to do with different conventions that different people use. So all I want to say is that our character chi on Z mod Z star determines a character on the ideal class group A star mod Q star, and if you take the inverse, that actually is the tells you how phi f changes on multiplying by on the left by z. Okay, so we have seen three properties of phi f. Now one is that on the g of r factor it is smooth, on the g of a f factor also it is smooth in the sense of locally constant. Third property is it has a central character. Okay, so the next slide, I'll discuss the next slide in greater detail next time, maybe. Or do I have time? What do you think, Saurabh? Do you think I should discuss it? Or so all I want to say is that we have discussed some properties of phi f. The remaining properties are all obvious adaptations of properties that we have already seen before. Okay. So for SL2 of R modulo gamma, there was this K infinity finiteness. Exactly that same property continues. Earlier, there was a Casimir finiteness, namely Casimir eigenvalue of K minus 1 whole squared minus 1 by 4. exactly as the same thing continues, except that, like, you know, g of a contains a g of r factor, and that makes the Casimir act, and therefore you can talk of Casimir eigenvalues. Then you have the central character property, then you have a growth condition, and then if f is a cusp form, then the definition, like, you know, the corresponding property of phi f is actually even easier, because for GL2 of R, SL2 of R modulo gamma, you had to worry about many cusps. One advantage of the Adelic formulation is that you don't have to put a sigma on the left and get a more complicated condition. There is only one condition for cusp forms. And the next thing, if I had time, what I wanted to do is that all of these conditions together motivate the definition of an automorphic form. Namely, look at what all the properties of EF were: left invariant smoothness, right K finiteness, Laplacian eigenvalue or Casimir eigenvalue, central character, and growth condition. If you put all this, you get the definition of an automorphic form on G of A modulo G of Q for a given central character. Okay, so that's namely, like, you know, that that's the same omega that I assigned to the Dirichlet character chi from Z mod n Z star. Okay, so this is what I wanted to do. Anyway, the last two slides I'm going to rediscuss next time. Okay, but there was really nothing to discuss. All the previous proofs from SL2 of R mod gamma directly adapt. Only thing is that whenever appropriate, you replace the compact group by the compact group at infinity. Laplacian, Casimir only acts through infinity and so on. But yeah, so that's the only difference here. So I think I'll stop there. Any question?
Is there any question?
I got some feedback. Sorry.
Okay, I continue.
No, like, I got some feedback yesterday. Today also, if you can give me feedback, I mean, you know, you want to need to be to change some aspect, feel free to.
And so okay, there is a question in the chat.
Okay, good.
So I will read it out.
Yes.
So why don't we have to deal with the multiple cuspidality condition in Adelic formulation?
That's a good question. To be honest, I haven't really worked through the details, but I think the reason is as follows. If you try to go from one cusp to another cusp, you have to translate by something which does not really lie inside gamma naught of n, right? But when you talk of G of A modulo G of Q, you are somehow dealing with every single gamma naught of n at the same time. Okay, so first of all, that difference is not seen. And some second heuristic as to why they might probably be the same is that, you see, the problem was that, you know, for SL2 of Z, you needed only one cusp, right, at the infinity. And the reason why you needed only one cusp is that SL2 of Z acts transitively on all the cusps. Whereas with gamma naught of N, the problem came with the fact that gamma naught of N acted transitively on only some of the cusps. Okay, so to capture the remaining cusps, you have to act with elements of SL2 of Z, which does not belong to gamma naught of N. Here you have G of Q. Okay, G of Q acts transitively on all the cusps, right? I mean, think of the picture, right? You have upper half plane, and to compactify, you are not adding R union infinity. You are actually adding Q union infinity. It's a very weird thing to compactify upper half plane modulo gamma. You are adding points from Q union infinity. Okay, on Q union infinity, you can check that SL2 of Z acts transitively, G of Q also acts transitively, but gamma naught of N doesn't act transitively. Okay, so I think this is the philosophical reason why there is only one cusp. But to be honest, I haven't actually worked out this. I mean, you know, this is not quite what I do. I do completely local stuff. But if one of you know that this, if this is true or false, please let me know. Okay, maybe Ankit knows.
No, I don't know the answer.
Does this sound like it might be an explanation?
I'm sorry, I cannot, I think, add anything more.
okay. So, yeah. Okay. So, no, I'm just speculating. Okay. So, I'm kind of being a bit shameless in speculating. But, yeah, as long as you don't quote me on it and just use it as a heuristic, maybe it's not too hurtful. Any other question?
Yeah, so he has another question. Yes.
Okay.
Mayuk asked the question.
Can you read it out or you want to say it?
No, I'm just repeat. So if I took a non-arithmetic discrete subgroup gamma, what I do?
Okay, so that's a very good question. So you see, the thing is, when you talk of an arithmetic or a congruent subgroup, you see, it is defined not for SL2 over R, it's actually defined for SL2 over Q. Okay, so if you look at, so there are many different groups that can give rise to the same SL2 of R, okay? So you can choose the norm one elements of a of a division algebra over Q, and that leads to a certain set of congruent subgroups. Those will be co-compact, okay? And that also leads to a notion of arithmetic subgroups. So first of all, we are only dealing with those congruent subgroups which are associated to SL2 of Q, namely those that are very closely related to gamma naught of n, okay? So the scope of this particular exposition only deals with gamma naught of n and a small class of related groups, okay? Now you can ask, what about arithmetic groups which are not congruent subgroups, okay? What if something is not commensurable with gamma naught of n? In that case, the Adelic framework does not help, okay? So this you can say is probably a problem with the Adelic framework, namely, maybe it will be easier if I, remember I wrote this bijection, right? This bijection is actually the bijection at the bottom of this page. This bijection is actually more important than it might seem. This bijection roughly corresponds to the fact that if you look at the compact open subgroup K naught of N of G of AF, that somehow determines the congruent subgroup gamma naught of N of G of Q, okay? And that is related to the following that I wrote here. Sorry, I wrote some fact here at some point, right? I wrote that K naught of N G of R plus intersection. The second fact that I have written over here, number two here, G of Q intersection K naught of N G of R plus is equal to G of Q, okay? Is equal to gamma naught of N. So this is telling you that open compact subgroup of the GL2 over finite ideals gives rise to congruent subgroups, okay? So in fact, another way to define congruent subgroups is that those subgroups of GL2 of Q or SL2 of Q that arise in this way from some other compact open subgroup of GL2 of AF other than K0 of N, okay? But this way, only congruent subgroups can arise, not arithmetic subgroups. So Adelic framework does not handle arithmetic subgroups, okay? Whereas as far as I know, initially the works of Langlands on spectral decomposition, etc., dealt with arithmetic subgroups. But still somehow congruent subgroups seem to deal with most of the number theoretic applications. So, and Adelic framework has a lot of simplification and advantages. Already I said that there is only one cusp. So people seem to still deal mostly with Adelic situation, which loses arithmetic subgroups, but yeah, that's a fact of life. And for non-arithmetic subgroups, they may be arithmetic for some other groups than SL2, but they don't fall under the scope of this course. Sorry, I gave a kind of rambling answer, but is that okay or could you?
Is it okay, Mayuk?
Thank you.
Okay, it's helpful.
Is there any other chat question or?
No.
Lalit? Oh, no, that's from an
previous one.
Okay, that's, yeah. Okay. Any other question? No. So people do talk about arithmetic subgroup of SL2 of R all the time, though they have this sort of a notion of a Q structure in their mind. And there are arithmetic groups associated to, like, you know, SL2 of R modulo gamma is never compact. Conjugate to congruent subgroups are also congruent subgroups. Okay, so they can be discussed from the, they can arise from the Adelic framework. So only thing is that instead of k naught of n, you will have to use. But if it is g of r conjugate, I don't know. But g of q conjugate, you just change k naught of n to some other subgroup. Any other question?
Any other questions or comments?
So next time will be like, you know, a repetition of many things that we saw in lecture two, but I'll try to do it in a kind of gentler way without as much representation theory, but in the Adelic framework. Okay, so that's what I plan to do next time.
Okay, if
yeah, so I guess I'll stop sharing.
Okay, if no more questions, so we can thank the speaker for such a wonderful lecture. Then we will meet at 2:15, 2:20. Yeah. We will have virtual lunch break.
Yes. See you.
See. It was quite wonderful lecture, sir. Quite informative.
Thank you. You are always encouraging,
with,
but
with quite motivating also. How to go from G one character to group set of all characters and so on.
Okay.
Then, okay. Yeah. If you share the slides, I think by today evening, so we can also upload it.
Yeah. I'll share the slides. Actually, yesterday also, I think I shared yesterday.
Yes. If you shared the slide, you have shared. Yeah. Today one.
Yeah.
We will.
Yeah.